which is nice. Now, here's Tom.
Saturday morning. Welcome to the Saturday Sports Page. I am your host, Tom Schmitz, coming to you live from the palatial studios of WOCA, just outside the food court entrance to the Paddock Mall in the Brick City Beautiful, Ocala, Florida. I'm joined, as always, on Saturday mornings by Luke Sylvia. Luke, how are you this morning?
I'm doing well, Tom. How are you?
On my way in to buy my Lightning hat.
Are you?
Along with
the rest of Ocala, huh? They're doing well. They've hit their stride. They didn't choke last night, so you're going to go buy yourself a Lightning hat.
You know, here's the thing. The Tampa Bay Lightning last night, they win a hockey game 4-3. They were up 4-0.
Going into the third period.
Mm-hmm. There they are. I'm looking for my glasses. I can't see a thing without my glasses. You'll get there one day, sir. Mm-hmm. So they're up 4-0 going into the final period. They somehow survive 4-3 after giving up 3 goals in the third period. And the series is now tied 2-2. And it only prolongs the agony of people who say they're Lightning fans, and they're really not.
No, okay?
Let's be honest.
It's incredible.
They're really not.
It's incredible because you've got people who are bandwagon fans of a team, and then you've got people who are bandwagon fans of a whole sport.
Yes.
And that's what these people are.
Yes, because here's the thing. Here's what I want you to do. I want somebody to call in without Googling. And see, we're not going to be able to do this because somebody's going to Google.
Oh, of course. That's why we have follow-up questions on Tuesdays.
Chris Halley, who is the golf pro at Ocala Muni.
Right.
Ocala Golf Club.
Yeah.
He's a big hockey guy, too. We've had him on the radio talking about hockey.
Mm-hmm.
He gets just as irate about this as I do and you do, about people who are all of a sudden Tampa Bay Lightning fans.
It's incredible.
He says, here's his test. And this is a test you should use, Luke. Mm-hmm. You should use this test. Okay, I'm going to give you this test. And this is how you can – you know how when you see people dressed up like – well, they'll wear Marine Corps stuff and everything, and an actual Marine will go up and ask them a question, and they fail the test miserably, and then the Marine gets all mad because they're faking that they're a Marine?
Yep.
Well, hockey fans do the same thing. They fake that they're hockey fans.
Oh, of course.
And Chris Halley has a undisputable – test to see if they're actual hockey fans of the Tampa Bay Lightning. Would you like to know what the test is?
Yeah, probably something to do with name of players or how many rings they have.
He says, this is Halley's thing. He says, name me 5 players on the Lightning and Stamkos can't be one of them. Can you do it?
Mm-mm.
Okay, by the way, neither can I.
No.
And I watch hockey all the time. I'm a Rangers fan. I watch hockey all the time. Stamkos is all I got for the Lightning.
I used to play NHL video games a lot, so I used to have more. But no, I'm not a hockey fan. I'm not gonna lie, I'm not a hockey fan. I know how the playoff format works. I know how hockey works. I know most of the rules. That sometimes it gets confusing, but no, I know most of the rules. And Tom, I have a good example of someone who really who is a bandwagon hockey fan, and then that translates to a bandwagon Tampa Bay fan. So I was on my Twitter the other day, right?
Right.
The series right now, at the time, was 1-1, I right. believe. So 1-1. It was 1-1.
Right.
The Lightning end up, I feel like there's some late game stuff that happened. The Lightning couldn't pull it out the other night in that game when it was 1-1. So the Penguins take a 2-1 lead in the series.
Right. By the way, I don't like the Penguins. I just want to go ahead and put that out there because they beat my New York Rangers, just so you know.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, that was like two rounds ago.
Thank you for bringing that back up.
I'm actually looking for the post on the social media. I will not release a name, but she said...
So this was a girl then. Good, good.
This was a girl, yes.
Big Lightning fan.
She just completely... She bleeds blue and white now.
Huge Lightning fan.
She tweets and says... She deleted it, so, you know, I don't know word for word, but she did say something along the lines of, well, we could have just lost the entire series.
We,
first mistake. Second mistake, the series is 2-1 now. You didn't just lose the series.
No.
You play a best of seven, simplistically, first to win four games, and it's 2-1, and your team just lost the series. Your team that, you know... You're just a diehard fan of.
Yeah.
And that's 2-1. It's over. It's over, Tom. Last night it almost felt like it was over. It was about to be 3-1 in the series if they kept choking. But and I'm not trying to bash Tampa Bay. It's most of the time, I've said it on the air before. Some people differentiate in this opinion. I dislike teams because of their fans. For the most part, unless we have a bad history of playing that team, like it's FSU or something.
So then you dislike Miami Heat?
Not so much anymore.
They're fair weather fans.
Listen,
as long as they're winning, they're watching the game.
When LeBron was there, I had it was an in-state rivalry. When LeBron was there, it also wasn't much of a rivalry for the Magic because, well,
let's be honest, the last LeBron 20 James. Years hadn't been much of a rivalry for the Magic.
Hey. That's not true. That's not true because back when Dwight Howard was there and we made it to the finals,
You know. Because there was nobody else in the East that could play.
Well, that's been the story forever. So, I mean, besides that. But there were the Heat back then, but not with LeBron, unfortunately. But, no, I mean, that's just my point. I don't like bandwagon fans. I can't stand them. I went through my Golden State phase where I was all high on Golden State and everything like that. And ever since I went and watched them play the Magic, Tom, they played the Magic in Amway Arena.
You're a bandwagon guy.
No. Listen. Oh, listen to this. Guy. In Amway Arena, I have my Magic gear on. I did not put Warriors gear on.
Uh-huh.
I'm in the arena, and the Magic or the Warriors are shooting free throws. Nobody's making noise because they don't want to disrupt the Warriors. And ever since that game, I can't cheer for the Warriors. I went to that game and I realized I can't. I mean, they're exciting to watch, but I can never be a fan because the bandwagon fan base is so big, I couldn't handle it. And one of my friends is a huge bandwagon Golden State fan. He says "we" all the time, Tom, talking about Golden State. And his brother calls him out on it all the time. I love it.
Oh, yeah.
It's great. He said, well, where were you 2 years ago? You know.
When Golden State was terrible.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yep.
Yeah, and it does aggravate me seeing all these Tampa Bay Lightning. But you know what it doesn't? You know who it doesn't aggravate? The people that own Lids in the mall.
Oh, they're thriving right now.
I mean, every day I see 10 or 12 bags come out of there with people putting on Lightning hats.
Incredible.
I'm a huge Braves fan. I could be a Tampa Bay Rays fan if I wanted to. They're right here. They play pretty good baseball. But I'm a huge Braves fan. By the way, right now, the worst team in Major League Baseball. What are they? What's that team, Luke?
The Atlanta Braves.
The Atlanta Braves.
Yeah.
That doesn't matter to me. Still watching the Braves on Sports South when they're on TV. Still watching the games. Still
watching getting your 75 or is it 92? How many?
I don't know how many games. 130, I think Buddy said. I don't know what it is. But I'm still yelling at the TV.
Right.
I'm still angry, although they did fire Freddy Gonzalez this week. And
they got a win last night.
They did win
a big
last
win,
night.
Not a big win, but a large margin of a win.
Well, yeah, they won by a bunch last night.
Yeah.
But what I'll show you a text. This is, and these are Braves fans through and through right here, brother. You can never say that these two guys that are doing this talk are not Braves fans. I'm going to read you a text messaging between two Braves fans earlier this week. Got to find it real quick. Okay, I can search for here. Here we go. Let's do it this way. Okay. So here we go. Said, Freddie gone, day for celebration. That was the first text, the day Freddie comes out, Tuesday when he got fired. The text then goes, Freddie was terrible, but there's no manager in Major League Baseball that's going to make that team win. Yeah, but he should have been gone long ago. No, more accurate, he should have never been hired in the first place. Fact. That is a text between myself and another huge Braves fan, J.J. LaSalva. This is, I mean, Freddie gone, day for celebration. Now, that's fans. When Scott Skiles got fired, when Scott Skiles quit because the front office couldn't see eye to eye with him.
Yeah.
You're a fan of the Magic. You texted me and said wrong person left today.
Yep, wrong person left, but it did turn out to be a blessing in disguise.
Frank Vogel
is now the official head coach of the Orlando Magic.
But that's a true fan.
It is, yeah.
Okay.
When you know things about the management and all of the staffing, that's when you're a true fan.
A fan isn't someone who says, ooh, the Lightning are in the playoffs. What sport is that? Ooh, let's go buy a Lightning hat.
Yep. See, and my magic test to know if people are true fans, I either ask them the GM's name or ask them to name me, the starting five.
Well, we're going to take a break. We come back, we'll talk with Buddy Martin live on the air. We'll talk about the Preakness. It's coming up today on NBC. Speaking of NBC, some good news I'll get to tell you about here in a few moments live on the air about NBC. We're going to take a timeout right now, though. You're listening to 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, WOCA, The Source.
Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. And so is State Farm agent Angie Lewis, working hard to serve her community as a citizen and insurance agent. Angie wants to help you as you adjust your insurance needs to your life, from everything to helping educate your teen driver to protecting your family against everyday risk. She wants to change the way you perceive insurance by developing relationships with her clients, which is why Angie and her staff are proud to be a part of so many good causes in Ocala. In turn, she has chosen to single out those who step up as leaders. Each month on The Voice of Ocala, Angie spotlights a good neighbor, saluting those who give exceptional service or do random acts of kindness to others. For this, Angie was written up in State Farm's National Magazine. Angie also supports local businesses with a regular Biz Buzz.
Hi, I'm State Farm agent Angie Lewis. Come see me and my team for all your insurance and financial needs in the beautiful downtown historic district, 416 East Fort King Street, or call 291-2444.
This is Kendall Carpenter with Golden Ocala Golf and Equestrian Club. I want to introduce you to the finest equestrian opportunity available. If you love horses and enjoy Central Florida's mild climate and rich rolling landscape, come explore Golden Ocala. Bridle trails weave their way through this stunningly beautiful community of stately homes. Our state-of-the-art equestrian center will meet all of your equestrian needs with style. Visit us at goldenocala.com.
Essential oils work as natural distressors with seemingly endless benefits to health and wellness. Dare to Believe partners with doTERRA certified pure therapeutic grade essential oils to help you feel regenerated with many of the services offered, including Aroma Touch. To set up your consultation today with wellness advocate Valerie Hazelden, call 352-425-5588. That is 352-425-5588. Dare to Believe, it's essential.
If you missed Buddy's sports page recently, longtime columnist Dave Kindred talked about the relationship between Pee Wee Reese and Jackie Robinson of the Brooklyn Dodgers.
The only story that he told me about that kind of relationship involved an exhibition game in 1947, Robinson's rookie year in Atlanta. The exhibition was in Atlanta. Robinson received a letter saying that he would be killed if he showed up on the field. They're warming up, Robinson and Reese side by side, and the way Pee Wee told the story to me was that he said, Jackie, would you move away from me a little bit? The guy might be a bad shot. That's the only story that Pee Wee ever told me that has anything to do with, you know, a black-white relationship.
Remember, for all the latest sports news, you can hear it all on Buddy Sports Page every weekday from 5 to 6 o'clock, right here on The Source.
Welcome back to the voice. I always do that. Welcome back to the Voice of Ocala. Welcome back to the Saturday Sports Page. I'm Tom Schmitz. Joining me on the line now is the host of Buddy Sports Page, the host of Southern Pigskin Tonight, and the revered national columnist, Buddy Martin. Buddy, good morning to you.
Oh, I didn't know it was me. I thought somebody else that you said my name. All that accolades, I thought it was maybe you're going to have like Woody Page or Joe Williams or something like that.
Yeah.
So, Tom. How you doing?
Wonderful, buddy. Hey, it's Horse Day. Today is the 146th running of the Preakness Stakes. Cherry Wine, Uncle Leno, Awesome Speed, Exaggerator, Lanny or Lanai, I don't know how you say that, Collected, Leoben, Abiding Star, Fellowship, and Stradivari, all trying to knock Nyquist off and prevent a triple crown. Are you excited about the race today, buddy?
Well, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not as excited about the Preakness as I am the Derby. And even then, the Belmont, when there's a triple crown winner, contending. You know, we talked to both Michael Compton and Augie Griner yesterday about this race. And what they said about it was, is that it has a lot of speed. There's a lot of speed in this race. And it's not going to be the same kind of race as the Derby. So, and I guess it's supposed to be a sloppy track in Baltimore today.
Started raining about 7 o'clock this morning. I was watching NBC, the Today Show weekend edition, and it was pouring rain in Baltimore. And it's supposed to rain all day, which makes the track just like the Santa Anita Derby when Exaggerator won on that track that was a sloppy mess. But they say Nyquist has run, he won the Florida Derby on a wet track, so that he runs pretty good in the slop, too.
Well, we talked about that yesterday with Augie, and the fact is that Nyquist does seem to run on whatever you give him, but you can't get over it. There's no question. I saw the replay of the Florida Derby, and that track was nowhere near like it was in Santa Anita. An Exaggerator came through and stuff. So I don't know much about mutters. I can't understand why sometimes it bothers them, sometimes it doesn't. But based on what they said, the experts say, you and I, we're just a couple of guessers. It sounds like these two horses are the best. And in some order, as Augie said, they'll be one and two. So pick your poison. On the other hand, it's horse racing, Tom.
It is horse racing. Anything can happen. We've seen, six, 7 years ago, maybe 8 years ago now, a 50-1 win the Kentucky Derby and run. So they run the race for a reason, buddy.
Yeah, and so we'll see if one of these other horses breaks through or not.
Well, let's talk a minute about
We don't know much about their past performances. We certainly know about the marquee horses that you mentioned. So we'll see that it's a run for the Black Eyed Susans, and I'm sticking with my horse. I'm sticking with Nyquist, obviously, an Exaggerator, and I'm going to go for my third horse, Stradivarius, out of the 11 hole. It's just he was about 8-1, 9-1. I know Augie likes Cherry Wine is one of his picks in there. So that's also one that Michael Compton picks. So might be good to include that if you're doing a four course box or something. Or either, I know you're putting Nyquist on top and you're putting Exaggerator on top, but you might want to throw a little bit of that little Cherry Wine in there on your Exacto or your Trifecta, whatever you're doing.
Cherry Wine 21-1 as of this morning. Uncle Leno 40-1, Nyquist 4-5, Awesome Speed 45-1, Exaggerator 9-5, Lanny or Lanai, I don't know how you say that, 25-1, Collected 13-1, Leoben 60-1, Abiding Star 30-1, Fellowship 50-1, and Stradivari 7-1. So those are your those are your morning race odds this morning at Pimlico in Baltimore. Buddy, let's talk for a minute. Let's switch gears and talk for a minute. We talked about this on Southern Pigskin Tonight, and I think it bears repeating. we over the past 2 weeks we've kind of ranked coaches in the SEC, and then this week we ranked coaches in the ACC. And the rankings, what I want to talk about. I want to ask you again so you can explain again. A lot of people, I've had last night, I had two people say, do you guys really believe what you say on the radio? And I said, well, yeah, we wouldn't say it. And the question was about ACC coaching starting to catch up to SEC coaching. This person was vehement. The two people I was talking to were vehement in their belief that the ACC coaching ranks are nowhere near the SEC coaching ranks. And I don't believe that. And you said as much this week as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think good coaches are good coaches. I think the SEC has been really blessed to have the talented coaches they've had. And I remember Gary Danielson saying this 6 or 7 years ago in an interview I did with him for a story. He said the SEC is poised to have a great run. They got incredible coaches, and they got great talent. He said they're going to get to an era where they're going to dominate. Well, that's exactly what happened. That's what happened the last 7 years is the SEC dominated. They had obviously the TV contract help, but they've been dominant. Now, I think the other leagues are starting to catch up. And we're going to see expansion, too. There's no question there's teams sitting out there. They know that they're never going to get into the playoff if they don't catch up on the Big Five. So I anticipate everybody, but perhaps the SEC, maybe the SEC, too, but perhaps everybody but getting another couple of teams in the near future. And so I think my original prophecy, Tom, if you remember, was about 80 teams. So I was talking about this 25 years ago, that one day there'd be alliances and there'd be conferences and they'd have a total of 80 teams, and the conferences would drive the playoffs, et cetera, et cetera. That's pretty much what happened. So the coaching is certainly central to this, but let's be honest, there's some new coaches coming up now that we are going to see in the ACC. We talked about on Southern Pigskin, I think Fuente is a guy that, and we know what Bronco Mendenhall can do at BYU, but what can he do in a bigger conference in Virginia? And I think there's no question that the ACC has helped itself with coaches. So let's see how that plays out, and let's see if the paradigm shifts a little bit away from the SEC. And I don't think you're going to see the Big Ten become a powerhouse top to bottom. But I think what you'll see is maybe you'll begin to see a little more ACC activity in postseason, better teams coming out of there. And we'll see how that matches up. So it would be great for Southern football because to have the ACC and SEC go head-to-head, the fans would benefit from that.
Well, when you look at the coaches, of course, Nick Saban's at the top of the SEC. There's no argument with that. Then you have some high-profile coaches that are really good. You got Jim McElwain, who I think even though he's only been at Florida 1 year, has shown that he can win, or at least he could win. He won last year. You have coaches like Les Miles, but the SEC lost some stellar coaches. They lost quite possibly one of the five best coaches ever to coach in the college ranks from the time football started, in Steve Spurrier. And Mark Richt, all he did was average 10 wins a year for 15 years at Georgia, and he's in the ACC now. I think, and you can, I'll get your thought on this. I think talent is where the ACC may fall behind the SEC now, not in coaching.
Yeah, well, as we said on the show, that they have to keep some catching up on talent. But look, Florida State's recruiting like an SEC team, and I think that's the key. Is they're recruiting like an SEC team, and Urban Meyer. I mean, one of the coaches told me on Urban Meyer's staff. The reason we're going to be better, we're better than everybody else, is because we play like an SEC team in Columbus. And that's what they're doing there. So the SEC is a long way from being over with. You mentioned the coaches that have been gone, certainly Spurrier and Rick being a big part of that. Had Les Miles gone, I mean, it would be only Nick Saban standing alone as sort of the dean of the coaches. So we talked about this on the show 2 weeks ago. Who's going to step up behind Nick Saban? Would it be McElwain? You know, what's Kirby Smart going to be like in Georgia, et cetera? It has to settle in a little bit to see what the landscape is going to be. But by the way, Tom, I heard this week Danny Sheridan, the odds maker, on Paul Feinbaum's show, pick the SEC champion. You're never going to guess who he picked.
LSU.
Correct. And he picks Tennessee to win the East and LSU to beat Tennessee for the championship.
Wow.
So, I wouldn't be too quick to count out Nick Saban yet, but let's see. Let's see what happens there. So LSU, it'd be funny if he won the SEC and they almost fired him last year.
Well, you know, he does have quite possibly the greatest football player on in college right now, Fournette. I mean, this guy is, to me, head and shoulders above every other talent in football right now. It's just a fact.
Well, you know, I've been on Leonard Fournette's bandwagon from day one when he stepped on the field, as you remember. And he's everything we thought he would be. And he's power and speed, and he's caught the ball fairly well out of the backfield, although they don't throw it that much. And they got the offensive – they're built offensively to run the football. And if they get Fournette loose and running and they can settle in at the quarterback position, that's been their biggest problem, then we're going to see LSU be right in there in contention. I think we'll see then. As always, though, Tom, there's so many freshmen already on campus. We don't even know who they are, who have a big voice in this whole thing this fall. And you're going to see, and I know Jimbo Fisher is talking about this kid Murray, who's hurt right now, wide receiver. There's dynamic players stepping in who are really not freshmen because they had this elite training. They came in early, and they'll step on the field and have the impact. So we'll see how it shakes down in terms of the talent level now. But right now, you're right, Fournette, it's tough. Let's don't forget about a guy in Tallahassee named Dalvin Cook or a guy in Clemson named Deshaun Watson.
That very good point. Those are two very good football players. Buddy, real quick, Luke and I have had a discussion this morning when we opened the show about our distaste for fair-weathered fans or bandwagon fans, people that don't know much about a sport, but because it's a city that they live close to and they start pulling for a team. And our point was the Tampa Bay Lightning, who tied the series last night with Pittsburgh 2-2. And a lot of people that are now Lightning fans tweeting out Lightning stuff and all that I would challenge don't even know very much about the game of hockey. But my question to you is, are bandwagon fans healthy for a sport? Are they good? Or are Luke and I making too much out of a thing that's fun in sports?
You sound like you're a bunch of elitists, if you ask me. You sound like a Red Sox fan. You think, you know, if you happen to cheer for the Tampa Bay Rays, you know, you're part of the, you know, you're really not legit. They feel like they're all the purebreds in Washington or the Yankees. You know, let the fans jump on board. It's fine. Look, I watched the Lightning game last night. Probably, two periods of it at least. And I watched the Rays win last night, too, despite two home runs by Cabrera. By the way, there's going to be some bad blood in that series. There already is. It's going to get worse in game five. So watch that. But, yeah, I think it's – look, I know what you mean. Sometimes you think in our world where we do this for a living and we follow sports closely that they have these fans that come aboard, Johnny-come-lately fans who want to get in on all the rah-rah-rah and whatever. I mean, look, let them have their fun, whatever. And it doesn't bother me like it used to, but I can understand why people say, hey – all of a sudden, you're a hockey fan. Where were you 5 years ago, you know? It's just how it is. And in this market today with television and media, you need all the fans you can get. So if they want to come aboard, I'd say leave room for them.
Well, there you go, Buddy Martin. He's more a sports aficionado than Luke and I are, experience-wise, for sure. Buddy, where's your column? Well, what's your column on this week, and where can it be found?
Well, Tom, right now my column is up on Southern Pigskin. I think today it's posted on Gridiron Now, and it's about something different about Jimbo, which we talked about on the show this past week. And I'm working on something next week I think you'll find interesting, and we may make this our roundtable topic, switch it up, and that is tribal colors. Is it how important are colors to a team? And I began looking at this because up in Columbus, Urban Meyer is suspending the ban on blue for one day. You know about this?
No.
And he's actually going to have let people wear blue on campus, his players, because Memorial Day weekend, it's red, white, scarlet, gray, it's gray and blue. So the blue mixes in with the flag for patriotic reason, which is a great idea, by the way. And you remember the story I had about going to Columbus and walking in the door with the blue sweater on.
Right.
And him quickly saying, hey, scarlet him up, man. Get that off of him. So all coaches have this tribal thing about colors. So I'm going to do a little study on that. It'll be the column for next week.
Well, you know, a coach that's very near and dear to my heart, he helped. He pretty much said, we're going to wear blue and white. That's going to be the colors. It's going to be very plain. You're going to have a number on the side. You're going to have a white number on the side of a blue helmet. You're going to have a white stripe down the center of the helmet. We're going to wear...
Joe Paterno?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I'm sorry.
We're going to wear white uniforms. It was patterned after the red and white of the Alabama Crimson Tide. But the reason it was blue and white is he said nobody can wear Alabama colors except Alabama. So Georgia Southern consequently is now the blue and white because Coach Russell had so much admiration for Bear Bryant that he wanted to do everything in the style of the Alabama Crimson Tide except for taking the red and white. So,
well, here's your assignment for next week. Think of the colors you can associate with teams. If you say these colors, what team is it? Don't say it now. I'm going to have a little quiz for you and Tom. I'm going to give you the colors. You tell me the team.
Well,
right?
I know
certain colors.
I know this.
Don't say them now.
I know there's one color. When my mother was alive, there was one color, one set of colors that I actually had a girlfriend that had to go back in the car and change out of because she wasn't coming to my mama's house in those colors.
There you go. Well, my mom everybody's got their travel colors.
My mom was a devout Gator fan all her life. So you I'll let you figure out red and black what those colors were.
Well, here's the deal. Here's the deal. When I think of Eric Russell, I think of only one color.
Red and black.
Red.
Yeah, that's good.
Because that's the color of the blood streaming down his forehead. When he butted a locker in the Florida game, and that's where his heart was as the defensive coordinator for the Georgia Bulldogs.
Certainly was. Hey, Buddy Martin, we'll find your columns at southernpigskin.com and gridiron.com, and I look forward to that quiz on colors coming up this week. Thanks so much. Thanks
good
so much for joining us.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Tom.
Buddy Martin, we're going to take a break. When we come back, I'm going to tell you some news about NBC Sports you might be interested to hear right here on 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, WOCA, The Source.
Good credits, bad credits. It's none of our business because we're not an auto dealer. We're not a bank. We're not your mother. We're OcalaForSale.com, Marion County's marketplace for cars, trucks, and SUVs. We've got thousands of sellers standing by to take your call. No middleman. But hurry, don't walk, don't run. Just sit down and log on to OcalaForSale.com.
Prices and inventory change daily. Offered as non-include dealer upcharge. Undercutting, rust proofing, factory surcharge, or delivery fee. See website for details.
Attention passengers for flight 1370. The plane has been delayed at its departure point and will be at least 2 hours late. We apologize for any inconvenience.
Are you serious? It took us over an hour to get here, 2 hours going through security and getting our tickets, and now we have to wait another 2 hours.
Yeah, it's beautiful here, but we're inside this overcrowded airport all day because the plane is stuck in bad weather.
This is the last time we ever do this. When we get back, we're going to Ocala Aviation and getting our pilot's license.
Yeah, we've been talking about that long enough. It's about time we did it. Then we could just fly ourselves and never have to deal with this mess again.
Right. No long lines, no full body groping security, no baggage checks.
Not to mention never losing your luggage. Remind me again why we haven't done that?
Well, we're idiots.
Oh, right.
Attention all passengers for flight 1370. It looks like the plane is going to be delayed a little bit longer. The airline has lost the pilot's luggage. Isn't it time you got your pilot's license? Call Ocala Aviation today. 352-861-7484. That's 352-861-7484. Hey, you've earned it. Call today.
Here's what you may have missed on the John Tesh Radio Show.
Just a 1 degree increase in body temperature can make it harder to fall asleep and stay asleep. To make yourself twice as happy today or tomorrow or the next day, it's very simple. Do 5 good deeds all in one single day. Get on LinkedIn. It turns out 89% of companies have used it to find new hires. And post a professional-looking photo.
Intelligence for your life on the John Tesh Radio Show. Don't miss this stuff.
Don't get caught without your daily source of senior deals. Pick up your copy of the Senior Voice newspaper. It's your source for schedule and events tailored to seniors with information you need, like a list of free events in the area. We even have Tom's Picks, a free referral for people who are looking for a company to do work for them. Tom's Picks will refer the company to you that fits your needs. And all we ask in return is that you tell them where you heard about them. For more information, call Tom's Picks, 352-804-1223. And pick up your copy of the Senior's Voice at most any business up and down the 200 corridor.
Now read Ocala Downtown Newspaper online.
Putting the local back into radio. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. WOCA News. Variety. Information. Now. Keep your arms and legs on the inside at all times.
Hi, I'm Fran Darkington. When I need news, I pass the rest and tune to the source. WOCA.
Visit the WOCA website at www.wOCA.com.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the Saturday Sports Page. I'm Tom Schmitz, along with Luke Sylvia. We are coming to you from the palatial studios of WOCA Radio, just outside the food court entrance to the Paddock Mall in the Brick City Beautiful, Ocala, Florida. Big news, Luke, June 1st. You ready for this?
Mm-hmm.
June 1st, WOCA will be moving to NBC Sports Radio on the weekends.
Really?
Yep. NBC Sports Radio will be coming to WOCA on June 1st. It will give you all the horse races, so you'll be able to listen to the Breeders' Cup on the radio. You'll be able to listen to all the Triple Crown races. Not this year. You'll be able to listen to the Belmont this year,
yep.
But not the Preakness, as we have Fox Radio right now, Fox Sports Radio. But June 1st. NBC Sports, can you pull up the weekend lineup there? Do you have that? I'm trying to get it on my phone now.
Yeah.
Can't see it here. NBC Sports Radio weekend.
Yeah, weekends, I got it. Yeah. Let's see. Do you want me to start with 12 a.m. to 1 a.m.?
No, just give us the daytime, like 6 a.m. through.
Let's see. 5 a.m. is the – or 7 a.m.
Uh-huh.
The Safety Blitz with Rodney Harrison.
And that's on the weekends.
Right.
Rodney Harrison.
Saturday.
NFL former NFL great, I believe he's in the Hall of Fame.
Then you've got the opening drive with Matt Chernoff.
That's on right now. Matt Chernoff's great. Good show.
So then you've got the Brian Weber show from noon to 3.
Brian Weber.
The Kate Delaney show.
Kate Delaney is very, very good.
3 to 5. The Two Robbies football show, 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. The Dave Smith show from 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. And the Scott Seidenberg show.
Seidenberg's a good guy.
9 to midnight.
So pretty good lineup on the weekends right here on NBC Sports. It'll be taking place June 1st. We make the switch to NBC Sports Radio June 1st here at WOCA. And I think it's going to be real big because horse racing is such a big deal in our community. And we'll be covering all the horse races. We'll have them live on the air here as part of NBC Sports. That's a big deal, I think.
Yeah, I think it's a you know, like you said, it is a big deal. Because the following of horse racing in Ocala is so prominent, just to be able to have, you know, the updates and everything like that, because really there's no, I've not really heard any sports radio, maybe I just haven't seeked it out as much, any sports radio that thoroughly covers horse racing. And it is something that once a year, especially with all of these events going on, you know, we've got the Belmont, the Kentucky Derby, the Preakness. When those events are on, you know, horse racing is the talk of Ocala because you got people talking horses, and it'll be good for them to get the advice from NBA Sports Radio for sure.
NBC, not NBA.
I said NBC.
You said NBA.
No, I did not.
Well
I might be thinking about NBA all the time. I'll text my mom. Say, what did I say, Mom?
We'll go back and pull the tape. You said NBA. You said NBA.
No, NBC.
So anyway, NBC Sports Radio is coming to WOCA June 1st. So looking forward to the partnership with NBC Sports. And, you know, wonder if they can get me on NFL Live on NBC Sunday night.
You think you could swing that one?
Think they would do that?
A guest show, live guest star.
That's what I'm saying. That's my point.
Yeah.
My point exactly.
We'll put something in for you then.
Maybe get in one of the booths, do a little play-by-play color for one of the NFL games.
Yeah, you might have to pray really hard to get in that.
No. Tom James probably get in there.
Probably.
You know, he worked for an NBC affiliate down in Orlando and in Fort Myers, so he may have some pull. You don't know about it.
He might have you on next week then. I don't know.
He's a two-time Edward R. Murrow winner, so you never know what he can do.
He's got some pull there.
He's got some chops. He definitely has some chops. Hey, baseball has decided to change some rules. That the rules committee has decided to make two changes that are going to go into effect in 2017. And it's really, one is really a rule that, why haven't you done this already? And the other one's a rule that, yeah, so what? They're going to do it the way they want to do it. And the rule changes are, no longer, starting in 2017, will you have to throw those four stupid pitches way outside the strike zone to intentionally walk a batter.
You save it.
Now the catcher can turn to the umpire and say, we're going to intentionally walk him, and the umpire tells the batter just to go to first base.
I think that speeds it up a little bit.
Why is this not – and I know purists, baseball purists, believe me, I don't like – I still am one who since 1970. I believe it was 1971 it was instituted. I still don't like the designated hitter. I think pitchers should have to hit. So I say, oh, pitchers can't hit. Why is they? Because they can throw a ball at somebody. They ought to have to face the retribution of getting one right back in the rib cage when they get in the batter's box and they hit somebody. But that's just me. But I know baseball purists will say, well, what about the wild pitch that could happen and then it could affect the game? And you're right. There have been wild pitches thrown when a pitcher's trying to throw that lazy ball outside to a catcher that's standing up with his hand out like this. You know, that wild pitches have happened.
Mm-hmm. They have?
Yeah. I went and looked at ESPN stats, had the stat up yesterday when I saw the story, when I read the story. Mm-hmm. A wild pitch has happened on an intentional walk in baseball. Mm-hmm. In the history of the game, since they started keeping stats,
right.
Their stats go back to 1893.
It's a long time ago.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Over 100 years.
Yep.
There's been 103.
Wow. How many years ago was that?
93 to 2016 is 93, 10, 20, 126 years.
So not even one per year.
Not one a year.
So who cares? Who cares? No one cares.
So baseball purist, you want to keep something that slows down a game so that you can stop a wild pitch happening that happens less than once a year.
And, Tom, do you agree that baseball should do all it can to speed up the game a little bit? Do you think it's become slow, or is that just me?
Unless you're a true baseball fan,
mm-hmm.
like I am.
Right.
Like Tom James is.
Mm-hmm.
Baseball's a boring sport. And it's a boring sport for one reason and one reason only. It takes too darn long to play
TV. And that's a prime example, you know. The intensive walk rule. It's a prime example.
The intensive walk rule, and I mean, it only saves about 60 seconds.
But it still saves, you know.
That's 60 seconds.
It culminates.
Okay, but if you save that 60 seconds, and then you make the batters not, you know, I think it should be a rule that you only get to tighten up your batting gloves one time in an at bat. Other than that, it's a strike every time you do it. And they say, oh no, it's a routine and our rhythm. Shut up! I played the game for a long time. I played baseball and I played softball. There's routine and rhythm, and then there's just wasting time. Stepping out of the batter, and I know baseball changed the rule last year where you got to keep a foot in the batter's box, but it's not being enforced very much by umpires. And they shorten the game by, are you ready for this?
Hmm.
6 minutes.
Wow. That's a big gap.
6 minutes.
Wow.
Dougie Fresher on. That's the only thing that 6 minutes is good for. A Dougie Fresh song, okay? Slick Rick telling Dougie Fresh 6 minutes you're on. 6 minutes to a baseball fan, and they say, oh, here's what they like to say. Say, yeah, but over 162 games, they saved well over 800 minutes.
Shut up.
So let me get this right. Over 162 games, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Over 162 games. You made the game about 48 hours shorter. Over 162 games.
Mm-hmm.
That's scary in itself that you were able to conserve 48 hours of game time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still a long game.
And
you could save – here's how you save time in baseball. You institute things like this, like right. the intentional walk. Put a clock up on the wall
mm-hmm.
in the center field. One right behind the pitcher's mound so the pitcher can see it. One in center field so the batter can see it. From the time the catcher throws the ball back to the pitcher, when it hits the pitcher's glove, somebody starts that play clock, just like in football. Referee blows the whistle, play clock starts. The pitcher's glove catches the ball back from the catcher, play clock starts. 20 seconds, 25 seconds, 20, 25 seconds. The next pitch must be delivered by then or it's a ball. You must be in the batter's box to accept that pitch, or, oh, well, it's a strike.
Mm.
You do that.
Yep.
You speed up the game that way.
Mm-hmm.
Because you'll watch some of these, like if a pitcher battles real good.
Right.
And a batter battles real good, and they get like 12, 13, 14 pitch at bats where he's fouling balls off and everything. That thing can take 5.5, 6, 7 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
You had a pitch clock on there. He's fouling the ball off and everything. That's down to 3 minutes. That's going to save time.
Yeah, and Tom, there is one thing before we go to break that's also in this article. We talked, you know, we said they are changing the intentional walk rule. They're also changing the strike zone.
Yeah, no, they're not. They say they are, but umpires are going to call it the way they want to call it.
Right. Because this article says from Yahoo that the strike zone is currently defined as the volume of space above home plate and between the batter's knees and the midpoint of their torso. But they said
it's not where the rule book says it is. I know that's where it is defined in Major League Baseball. You know what the baseball rule book says it is?
The umpire's liking?
No.
What?
The rule book says from the bottom of the armpit to the top of the knees. In reality, if you're standing up to hit, ball comes up here in your chest, that's not a strike. Hmm. But the rule book says this. In reality, an umpire strike zone is about the belly button to the mid-thigh. That's it. Unless he's calling low strikes. Unless he's got umpire. But it could change from pitch, depending on how the manager's yelling at him and everything. They're trying to get uniformity. I understand it. It's not going to work. We're going to take a break. When we come back, it's time to talk. The NBA playoffs, they're heating up. And I'm starting to think there may be a new favorite in town. We'll talk about that next right here on 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, WOCA, The Source.
Your quality of life is meant to be fully enjoyed each day. The doctors at Ayers Global understand that and strive to provide a quality of life for you that has no equal. Ayers Therapeutic Services combines naturopathic and family medicine to help all your health needs. Diabetic management, hypertension, pain management, and anti-aging are just a few of the services offered by the Ayers family. Call 352-512-0222 today, and Ayers Therapeutic Services will help you begin to understand that better health begins with you.
Michelob Ultra is more than a superior light beer. It's taking in all life has to offer, like catching a wave or biking a long trail. And when you're done, you reach for a cold Michelob Ultra. Fewer carbs, fewer calories, more to look forward to. Michelob Ultra, long live the ultra life. Enjoy responsibly. Michelob Ultra Light Beer, 95 calories, 2.6 carbs, 0.6 grams protein, and 0 grams fat per 12-ounce serving. Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri.
Hello, everybody. This is Terry Bradshaw, Fox NFL Sunday. Whenever I'm in Ocala, if I'm not picking and singing with my buddy Mel Tillis, then I'm listening to my longtime friend Buddy Martin on WOCA. Of course, I rarely get to Ocala, so if you believe that, I've got some horses I'd like to sell you. Some of them even have four legs. Regardless, I highly recommend you listen to Buddy Martin's Sports Page weekdays at 5 p.m. right here on The Source.
Hello, I'm Dawn Lovell, lead event designer and owner at Party Time Rentals. Have you ever wondered what it takes to make an event spectacular? Well, look no further. It's what we do every day. Whether you're hosting an intimate dinner for 10 or a gala for thousands, at Party Time Rentals, we find just the right style and elegance to make your event a success. Our extensive inventory of the finest in chandeliers, tents, crystal, china, and specialty items is featured in our fabulous showroom. Stop by and say hello. It's a great way to get ideas for an event and experience for yourself how you can make your party time special.
Party Time Rentals, located on Southwest 10th Street, just off Route 200 in Ocala, and off Southwest 34th Street in Gainesville. For more information, call 352-629-8858. That's 352-629-8858. The party begins at Party Time.
Right on the southwestern corner of the square sits one of the finest dining establishments in Florida, Mark's Prime Steakhouse and Seafood Restaurant. Mark's offers big city dining amenities in a charming and small town setting. It's a rare treat to experience both the ambiance and the exquisite cuisine in a friendly atmosphere. Ocala's finest restaurant serves the finest beef, the freshest seafood, premium wines, and naturally fresh vegetables. From valet parking to splendid service, Mark's offers the complete package. Check it out today. Mark's Prime Seafood and Steakhouse Restaurant.
Welcome back to the Saturday Sports Page on this overcast Saturday morning. Supposed to rain today, Luke?
I looked this morning and there was no rain.
I'm trying to get my golf on, you know what I mean?
Yeah, of course you are. It's Saturday and you're just trying to get out there and play.
I'm taking 18 holes at Ocala Golf
Club. It looks like it's overcast all day. And that's it.
I don't see any rain on the radar.
I don't see any either. And actually for the next 5 days after, about a week, a little less than a week, we are sunny all the way through. Who knows, it's Florida, it'll change, but you know.
Let's talk NBA basketball for a minute.
Yes.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
The Golden State Warriors and the Oklahoma City Thunder are in a epic battle.
Yep.
Kind of surprised that OKC went into Golden State and stole a game.
Especially game one.
You would think that they wouldn't be able to steal a game, especially game one.
Mm-hmm.
But they did. They went in 108-102 and really stole the game, doing something that I didn't think they would do. They listened to Billy Donovan, the first-year NBA coach, and they played defense in the fourth quarter.
Did they ever?
I mean,
incredible.
And as being a Gator fan, mm-hmm. me watching the Florida Gators for years with Billy Donovan as a coach, mm-hmm. I saw the similarities of Gator defense.
Yeah,
that he had these millionaires play.
And that's something that the game lacks. And if you can get a team, an NBA team, to play college defense, you can win. Your chance of winning increases.
Nobody knows how to deal with that.
No.
Nobody in the NBA knows. That's why everybody says, why was the Miami Heat so good with LeBron James, Dwayne Wade, Chris Bosh? No, wasn't just because they were superstars. It's because they played clamp-down defense.
Yep.
And the defense I saw, if the Oklahoma City Thunder played that defense, Billy Donovan could get them to play that defense throughout, the Golden State Warriors are in for a long 7-game series.
They are, and then you have to think, how does that translate, whether they win game 7 or not, which if it goes to game 7, they'll win. It's at Oracle. But then you have to think, how burnt out will
they be? What's that do to their legs?
Because you've got the Cleveland Cavaliers, who right now look like they're going to go unblemished throughout the Eastern Conference.
Yes.
They're going to go have a perfect record.
12-0.
Well rested, and they're going into the finals like that with a positive mindset.
And they play defense.
Yep. And also Steph Curry, as much as people don't want to say it, he's a liability right now in the sense he's banged up. He can injure his knee again.
Right.
Or his ankle. He's got paper ankles.
Yeah.
And until he started wearing those moon boots, the Under Armour shoes. So it's interesting. It'll be interesting to watch. I think the biggest problem, going back to that Western Conference matchup, the biggest problem between the Warriors and the Thunder is how big the Thunder are can help them, or it can hurt them.
When the Warriors go small,
mm-hmm.
the length of Kevin Durant and Adam, what's it? I can't say.
Steven Adams.
The length that they have bothers the small ball that the OK City Thunder try to play.
The Golden State Warriors, yes.
I mean Golden State, because they're very long.
Yeah, they are.
Oklahoma City Thunder are very, very long.
But there are some problems that poses for Oklahoma City.
Quickness,
because you saw many times Draymond Green, who's very much a do-it-all player. He's very quick. He's big. He's strong. You had guys like Steven Adams or Enes Kanter, the big men for Oklahoma City out there, playing the 4 and the 5 spot. They'd rush out to close out on Draymond Green.
Draymond would just say,
all right, bye.
Yeah,
and you take it out, and you saw Draymond make smart passes, kick the ball to Klay Thompson in the corner countless times, and him shoot that three ball.
All it's going to take is one off shooting night, and Oklahoma City Thunder will be in control of the series.
And I believe that'll be very imperative going back to Oklahoma City Sunday for Game 3.
That's why I've changed who I believe is the favorite to win the NBA title.
Have you really?
I said going into the playoffs it was Golden State's to lose.
Yep.
I think the nature of how they're having to play their guts out to beat Oklahoma City, mm-hmm. although they did blow them out in game 2.
Yep. I like where you're going with this.
I think that a healthy, and this the prerequisite is they stay healthy. Mm-hmm. I think a healthy Cleveland Cavaliers team should now be considered the favorite to win the NBA title.
Well, like we said,
they'll be rested.
Yep.
The only downfall is people out there will say, yeah, but they haven't been tested. But this team hadn't won a championship. The city hadn't won a championship. Its fans haven't won a championship since 1964. Oh, they're tested. Okay, they know the pressure of what's at stake here. LeBron James wants nothing more than to say, "Me, I, LeBron James, King James, was the first man to bring a title back to Cleveland since Jim Brown."
Yeah.
He wants to be thought of that way in Cleveland. That's why he went back. Mm-hmm. Even though Dan Gilbert said we'd win lots of championships before he won any.
And there's nothing, there's absolutely nothing scarier than seeing a close-up of LeBron James after he makes a bucket or after he makes a chase-down block. There's nothing scarier than a 6'8", 250-pound man just staring into the camera lens, daring any superstar like Stephen Curry to come down the lane.
Oh, yeah. It's going to...
Absolutely.
Cleveland's going to play late 80s, early 90s NBA basketball when Golden State... If Golden State is fine... Or if OKC... It's going to... Some people are going to feel bone against bone in this matchup. I haven't seen that kind of look in LeBron James' eye since the second year he was in Miami. Mm-hmm. When he was willing the Heat with a hurt Dwayne Wade to a championship.
Scariest player in NBA basketball.
Scariest player in the game. That's why I think Cleveland Cavaliers should be the favorite to win the NBA title at this point of the playoffs. Hey, I want to thank our guest, Buddy Martin, for joining us. For Luke Sylvia pushing all the buttons, I'm Tom Schmitz. Have a great weekend, everybody.